go ahead and rise to your feet and we'll sing. Brethren, we have met to worship. Brethren, we have met to worship and adore the Lord our God. Will you pray with all your power while we try to preach the word? Higher ground. I'm pressing on the upward way to hide some pain every day. Seeketh after God. They are all gone out of the way. They are together become unprofitable. There is none that doeth good, no, not one. Their throat is an open sepulcher. with their tongues they have used deceit. The poison of asps is under their lips, whose mouth is full of cursing and bitterness. Their feet are swift to shed blood. Destruction and misery are in their ways, and the way of peace have they not known. There is no fear of God before their eyes. Brother William, will you go ahead and say prayer for the sermon today?
Gracious Heavenly Father, we just thank you so much for this beautiful Sunday morning, Lord. Thank you for bringing us together as a church family. Lord, we thank you for your provision, and thank you for the many blessings that you give us just through your holy word, Lord. Please bless Pastor's sermon, Lord. May it fill our hearts with your love always, and let us learn a lot from Pastor today for you, Lord, and that your gracious and willing, we pray. Amen.
Amen.
Amen. Amen. All right, go ahead and be seated, all of you. And today, the title of this message is Put the Fear of God Into Them. Now, I'm not going to get into who the them is here right away, but we're going to look at the passage here, which, as you know, is pretty negative at its heart. Man at his best state is altogether vanity. You ever known people that were full of vanity? People that are always saying, look at me, look at me. Man at his best state is altogether vanity. And it is vanity that drives a man to have the audacity to not fear God. Yet we are okay with fearing man, fearing doctors, fearing killers, fearing viruses, fearing diseases and disabilities. But God forbid, pun intended, that we should fear God. And I know that we're living in a day and age where fear is not really discussed, much less preached anymore. In America's churches today, it's all about
this.
It's all about love.
Thank you.
It's not about fear. So, I don't know about any of you guys here today, but it's kind of hard this morning to get up and get around today. I see a lot of tiredness on all your faces. But you're all here, and you made it.
Yeah.
So you might as well make the most of it.
Yeah.
Get in the Word of God and get something out of it.
Yes.
Fear of God is not really even discussed. In a lot of Christian circles, it's not ever preached. And most Christians, it seems, have a disdain for the concept of fearing God and fearing His punishment for sin. People will call it fear-mongering. People will call it fear tactics. I have family that hate Chick Tracks because they think that it's using fear. The Bible says the fear of the Lord is the beginning of wisdom.
Yeah.
And by fear of the Lord, men depart from evil. How in the world can we expect society as a whole to ever depart from evil if we don't ever talk about the fact that we need to fear God? Turn to Psalms 25:14 here. And we're going to look at a passage that has some pretty deep truths in it. And today, if you look at the world, if you have a fear of God, you're primeval. You're medieval. You are way past the times, and you are outmoded, outdated. You're archaic. Why should you fear God? And the Bible makes it clear that we are supposed to, but it's just something we don't really talk about. How can we expect the world to have a fear of God if the Christians don't have a fear of God?
Yeah.
Verse 14. The secret of the Lord is with them that fear Him, and He will show them His covenant. We live in a world, as human beings, that are inundated and enamored with this idea of secret. What's the secret to life? What's the secret to having success financially? What's the secret to a good marriage? What is the secret to a good church? I mean, we often ask that with the church and our family all the time. What is missing in the church? What is missing in the church? The answer is usually involvement. But people are looking for what is the secret to life period. What is the secret to you getting to where you need to be spiritually? And the secret is that you have been waiting for in your Christian life, that deeper understanding of what God wants from you and how to live it comes after you have learned to fear Him. Some of you, even in this room, I think, don't even have any fear of God, honestly. It's not a part of your vocabulary. It's not a part of your Christian walk. When I was at ABC, I know that I was doing a lesson on the fear of God, and one of the leaders of the church actually said, "I've never ever thought about fearing God before." Huh. That's a strange thing. People don't want to fear God, they just want to love God. I have people that tell me, you shouldn't get saved because you're afraid of going to hell. You should get saved because you love God. You can't love God until you know what God saved you from. You can't love God until you come to a grips with how wicked you are and how God demands holiness and righteousness in your life. Once you get that, then you'll be able to love Him. You don't love God. You have to, first of all, fear Him. You have to fear Him. For those of you parents in here, you do not understand how important fear is on the aspect of your kids. If your kids don't fear you as a father or as a mother, then you will never have them ever coming to a true love of you as parents. I feel like I'm talking a second language up here. Are you all okay?
Yes.
You have to have them fear you. And the reason our government is so bad is because the government doesn't fear you. When the government fears the people, you have liberty. When the people fear the government, you have tyranny. And that is where we're at. The fear has to be in the right thing, and you as Christians have to fear God in the right way. You need to drop the modern concept of God being lovey-dovey and embrace the God of the Bible that is complete, full, and someone that you should actually fear. And I'm not talking about reverential trust like Scofield may say in his reference Bible. We're talking about actual fear. The fear that a child has for his father if he has done wrong. You should have some fear when you sin because you know that God knows what you just did. God is not blind. God is not Joe Biden. He's actually cognizant of what you are doing.
Yes.
God will show you His covenant with you after you have learned to fear Him. Now that covenant may well be considered the Old Testament covenant, you know, but however, I tend to look at this as an individual covenant of life between the believer and his Lord that He reveals to you when you learn to fear Him. I can't put it into words, but when I was in high school, I remember coming to grips with, I need to fear God. I need to fear Him. And all of a sudden, when I learned to fear God, all of a sudden, I didn't fear the big bullies that were in the high school. I didn't fear the big football players. I was a skinny up. You look at me now, I was 160 pounds. Now I'm, you know, a lot
heavier.
And I should have been scared of these big, brawny football players coming up to me. But for some reason, I just knew that if I was doing right with God, I didn't need to fear them.
That's right.
And if you haven't got that yet, you need to get it. You need to get it. That fear is not something that will drive you into a corner where you're curled up in a ball in a fetal position. This is a fear that drives you to, I will be demanded to give an account of everything that I do to Jesus Christ one day. My goodness, I have to do it. And Lord knows I've fallen short so many times after those days. But it always comes back to, Who are you afraid of? When you get older and when you get to middle age, you know what you fear? You fear missing out on things. You fear, my goodness, I missed the boat. I'm missing out on that type of fun. And you need to knock that out of your vocabulary too, and just think about what you're missing out as a Christian. Thankfully, I've had some conversations with some of you in this church about, hey, I've never led somebody to Christ. I want to do that. It is the fear of God that drives you to that ambition. Wouldn't it be horrible to have Jesus Christ pour out all of his blood for you and you never led somebody to Jesus Christ by the time you get to heaven? You never helped fish somebody into shore? You could have thrown in the line a whole lot more. You could have put the bait in the water a whole lot more. I mean, Grandpa and Grandma and I and Daniel went fishing yesterday. We didn't catch anything. But hey, we probably didn't have the right bait. We were on the wrong side of the lake. It was too hot. And we didn't stay there long enough. You got to be patient. You got to be patient. All right. God will show you his covenant with you. This is a personal thing. Haven't you ever gotten to that point where it's not so much about your father, or your mother, or your brother, or your sister, or even about your pastor? It's about what do you have that you need to connect with God on? What do you need to connect with God on? What is that covenant that he has between you and him? That is yours and his alone. You see what I'm saying? That special bond, that special relationship, that special understanding that he wants to give to you and you alone. But you have to grab a hold of that and have some fear of God. And if you have that fear of God, it says, he will show them his covenant. The secret of the Lord, the secret that you've been looking for all these years, all these decades, is missing from you because you have refused to fear him. You have refused to take the time to look into his eyes and ask God, what do you want me to do? Will you please help me to fear you and nobody else? The Bible says, don't fear those which kill the body. Fear those which can throw the body and the soul into hell, which is God. You gotta fear him. David said, I made a covenant with mine eyes. A covenant with mine eyes. Why then should I think upon a maid? That's a personal covenant that you need to make with God. A covenant. You know what a covenant is? It's a promise. It's an agreement. God says, I want you to do this, and you shake God's hand and say, okay, I'll do that. That's an agreement. That's a covenant. What covenant have you made with God lately? What have you given up to God, to him? For instance, when people have babies, we haven't had that happen in this church yet, but back in the old church, we had, well, we even did it with our own son. We baby dedicated him. That is an agreement between God and I that he is God's property. And if God calls him to the mission field, go ahead. We are giving up our commitment, not our commitment, but our holding on him, that if when he comes to that age and he is called by God to do something, he needs to do it, and we're not going to get mad at God if God takes him. That's a dedication. That's an agreement. That's a covenant. What covenant have you made with God? You know, I don't think that you can have a real relationship, a good, strong relationship with God until you make a covenant with God. Your own covenant. What are you promising him? Don't you realize that's why we sing, I surrender all, I surrender all at this church? It's because I am trusting that the Holy Spirit will be able to be strong enough to kick you in the behind, strong enough to get you to finally say, okay, God, I'll give you that. I'll start tithing, or I'll start going to all the services, or I'll start going soul winning with Pastor John, or I'll start, you name it. All these different things. It is up to you and what the Holy Spirit is convicting you of, not me. I mean, I'll be honest with you. I wanted to do a sermon tonight. It's on my planner, my beginner's discipleship I was going to do. what you can do to help your pastor and church. And halfway through it, I was just sick to my stomach. And I'm like, I can't give this because I know that probably 70% of you would say, well, that's just pastor saying things that would advantage him. You see what I'm saying? There are certain things that would be much better if you heard Jeff say it, or Steve say it, or Zach say it, or Ray say it, or Dale say it, or my dad say it, or William say it. It would be much better. But coming from me, I can't do that. See, where am I going with that? You have to listen to God, and you have to make that covenant with Him, and you have to figure out what it is that is on your heart to give to Him. And sometimes even I have to say, okay, I can't give this message right now. I can't do it as much as I want to. I can't. So I have to change things up. Psalms 34:9. Turn to that. Psalms 34:9. Psalms 34:9. Have you made a covenant with God? I have decided to follow Jesus. Well, that's an agreement. That's a covenant. It's not an agreement that you just abandon 1 week from the time you decide to do it. If you decide to do something and make a covenant with God, an agreement with Him, and you decide to give up on it, He is going to track you down. He's going to hunt you down. And He's going to make life miserable for you until you submit. You say, what kind of a relationship is that? It's exactly what Jeff was talking about this morning. Father and Son. He is the boss. I am the Son. I am supposed to do what He tells me to do. And if I don't do what He tells me to do, those whom the Lord loves, He chases, and He scourges every son whom He receives. Nothing worse than getting whipped by your father.
Yes.
Psalms 34:9 says, "Oh, fear the Lord, ye His saints, for there is no want to them that fear Him." I look at the world and I see nothing but want. Do you ever see the Christmas Carol? It's probably the one with Jim Carrey, and I say that because all of them are different, right? It sticks more to the book. But there's a scene there where the ghost of Christmas Future has his veil that's going all the way down to the ground, and he sees two toes that are underneath his cloak or whatever, and it's one of the kids' names is Want. Want. I know that all of you kids want for service to be over. I know that all of you kids want me to stop and close in prayer and go home and go swimming in the pool. Amen. There are wants that we all have. But when you start to fear the Lord, you learn something that no philosopher, no psychologist can ever help you with, will never be able to answer this for you. Only Jesus Christ can. David said, "The Lord is my shepherd. I shall not want. That's interesting. As a believer that learns to fear the Lord, you have a new outlook on life where you don't want anything anymore. Because as the old adage goes, happiness isn't getting what you want. It is wanting what you got. That's a hard lesson to learn. But I can personally testify that in the darkest of moments with my wife and I, and with landlord problems in the past and all those other things, when I stopped focusing on what I wanted and trying to find the happiness within what we had, I had more peace. We all have wants, but we have to start wanting what we've got. Man, you know, I go home after church, whenever Lydia and I go home, and it's such an amazing feeling to pull up and just fall in love with what you got. And we all have to do that, man. We have to love the wife that we have. Women have to love their husbands. and you have to love the kids that you have. You have to start falling in love with your job. You have to fall in love with what God has called you into doing. If you're scared of soul winning, you got to start falling in love with... I love that sound. You know? You start to fall in love with that. It's not an obligation. It's a pleasure. It's a privilege. Hey, I get to knock on the door. If they get mad at me, it don't matter. The privilege and the joy of being able to do it and say, God, I did my best. That's wonderful. If you fear the Lord, you realize that you need to be grateful, and there is no happy pill in the form of a thing that you can get that will make you happy. Lydia and I are, you know, we just put up our pool, and we've been talking all year about, Lydia had this beautiful plan of putting up pressure-treated boards around the pool, and then putting horse salt mats underneath it, and then putting the pool on top. And after much, much labor and work, we finally got it done. And you know, there are other things along with that that I have noticed that have came to pass, and Lydia and I are so happy that we have them. But in the process of having them, I realized that doesn't make me happy. Anybody else ever been there?
Yeah.
You get what you want, and you're like, this is not making me as happy as I thought it would make me happy. But the concept of falling in love with what you got and just being grateful for what you got, that will make you happy. You then become happy with your life because you're happy and content with your God. Look at the verse again. It says, "Oh, fear the Lord, ye his saints." This is talking to you. This is not talking to lost people. It says, "Oh, fear the Lord, ye his saints, for there is no want to them that fear him." I think we all want certain things, right? But we have to be able to fall in love with what we have, and then all of a sudden the want goes away. The promise in Philippians 4 is that my God shall supply all your need. Not your want, your need. And if you can fall in love with what you have that you need, you will have mastered a great big part of life. Look at Psalms chapter 9, verse 20. And we'll close. Today will be a shorter message. Psalms chapter 9, verse 20. Okay, Psalms chapter 9, verse 20 says, "Put them in fear, O Lord." This is the psalmist praying. "Put them in fear, O Lord, that the nations may know themselves to be but men." The trouble is, we just all forget what the Bible says God is cognizant of 24/7. The Lord remembers that we are dust. We don't remember that. We think that we are all powerful. We think that we can do everything until your back hurts. Until your leg starts acting up, your sciatica starts messing up. You get an ache in your back and your neck, and you get all these things, and you start to realize, my goodness, I need help.
Yeah.
Unfortunately, we all go to Professor Ibuprofen before we go to the Lord Jesus. We go to Dr. Tylenol before we go to the Lord. And it says here, "Put them in fear, O Lord, that the nations may know themselves to be but men." Selah. If there is no fear before your eyes, if there is no fear before their eyes, and they don't want anything to do with God, then there is some pressure for you and me to live up to the standards God has made for us. Live in obedience to his commandments so that the world will see what we do, who we are, who God has transformed us into, and start wanting that. Tony Robbins, although I don't agree with him on a lot, there was one good thing that he said and that I really, really appreciate. And it's very true. He said, things won't happen for you until your want becomes a must.
Yeah, that's right.
Is it a must for you to have the Christian life that you know God wants you to have? Is it a must, or is it just some long distant desire? One day, I'll get there. One day, I remember walking up the steps with somebody and I said, hey, they were talking about exercising. And I said, hey, either today is going to be day one or it's going to be one day. There's a big difference. There is nothing more enticing than to behold a person that you used to see living one way, looking one way, acting one way, and then to see them completely transformed the next time they see you.
Amen.
You cannot get away from that person without hearing them say, what happened? Right? What did you do? What's been going on? Right? Because the concept that we have looking at you is one way. We're used to seeing you the way you are. And then one day, through all of this hard work that you put in to change your life for Jesus' sake, one day they will see you and they'll say, man, what happened to you? What happened to you? You're so different. There is nothing more inspirational, more exciting, more drawing, more compelling than to see someone change into what God wants them to be. And if they can see God change you, then they will realize that they are the only men that need a Savior.
Yeah.
The Bible says you need to do good works so that the world will see your good works and glorify your Father, which is in heaven. The goal of this church, among many other goals, but the big goal for you individually should be, am I doing the things in my life that will bring honor and glory to Jesus Christ? Is my presence in this world drawing people closer to Jesus, or is it pushing them farther away because I am a bad example? They have to be able to put a difference between a Christian and themselves. These people out there need to focus. They need to see these seven things in you. They need to see that you're focused on the right things. Where is your heart and mind and attitude geared at? Where are you putting all your coins in? What basket are you putting it in? Are you focused on your new life in Christ? Or are you focusing on what you did years ago that you're ashamed of? Are you showing kindness to those people in this world that honestly just drive you up the wall, make you angry, make you upset? Are you showing kindness to them? Are you showing strength by getting stronger in the Lord? Are you actually starting to memorize more and more scripture? Are you starting to be more of a witness for Jesus? Are you getting to be more bolder? Are you getting to be more physically healthy and empathy? Are you showing empathy towards those people that come at you and they say, oh, my father died, my brother's sick, my sister's in the hospital, I got this ailment, I got my sciatica, I got my lower back bothering me, I got this, I got that, on and on and on and on. Are you being able to show empathy, or are you pushing them away and saying, I'm so sick of hearing your problems? Are you showing empathy? And are you serving the Lord Jesus Christ? The world needs to see you putting your body where your mouth is. Well, he says he's a Christian, but I don't see him doing anything for Jesus. Hey, maybe the thing that your people need to see you do is to go soul winning and knock on their door. Aren't you? John, why are you knocking on my door? I know you. Well, I'm trying to change. I'm trying to live up to the testimony that is coming out of my mouth.
Amen. Yes.
I'm serving you. Patience. Do you have patience to not worry about enduring to the end for your salvation? Do you have patience to get into the fight, that fight, and pray and pray and read your Bible so that you can hopefully put the fear of God into other people by your example, by your words? It's going to take patience. I know some people that have prayed for their brother and sister to get saved for 70 years. And finally, after 70, 75 years, they get saved. Sometimes it takes a great deal of patience. Don't quit praying. Don't quit stopping. Don't quit doing right. Continuity. This is faithfulness. And that goes right along with this. How faithful are you? You know, people say, well, I got convicted that I need to tithe. And a month or two later, they stop tithing, right? Is that continuity? Is that faithfulness? I got convicted that I need to go to every Sunday night service. 2 or 3 weeks later, then they stop going. You see where that's going at? If you have the fear of God in you, the world will be able to see that you are the genuine article. And that's what we want the world to see in us. And trust me, this message is just as much for me as it is for you. Genuine article. Do you want to be a genuine article? It means humbling yourself and quickly saying, I'm sorry if you've done something wrong. You've got to make it quick. You've got to try to do right. And if you mess up, you've got to get right as fast as you can. You can't hold on to things and quit saying, I'm right, 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 I'm right. Pretty soon that gets old, doesn't it? Pretty soon you just have to humble yourself and say, I'm sorry. I'm sorry. Is this you? This is what the world needs to see in you. This right here is what the world needs to see in you. And if you do that, and you let the world see this in you, then guess what? They will start fearing God. As Ray begins to play the music, if God has worked on your heart, why don't you come forward to the old-fashioned altar, I should say, and pray? Why don't you come to the old-fashioned altar and tell God, Lord, I want to make today day one. I want to start having more fear. I want to start fearing you more. God's worked on your heart. Why don't you come forward at this time? The rest of you can turn in your hymnal to 162. Rise to your feet. And we'll sing the last song and we'll be dismissed. I wander far away from God. And all right, Brother Ray, will you close us in prayer?